So the Castro Peninsula is situated on the western coast of Lemnos Island in the northern Aegean Sea. It borders the present main port of the capital, Myrina, from the north. The hilly headland consists of lava domes, most rocks being of dacite to trachydacite composition of the lower Miocene, and its summit is at about 115 or 16 meters above present sea level. In addition to later occupation on Castro, mainly in medieval and post-medieval periods, in particular a Byzantine, Ottoman, Venetian, and Genoese castle comprising important buildings and a triple wall enclosure, a large number of earlier rock cut features were identified. In spite of destruction due to posterior activities involving subsequent modifications, several sectors of the headland still bear vestiges of early carved surroundings. The Castro volcanic milieu was carved into ensembles of rock cut structures in extended areas on various altitudes. Based on work in progress, the focus of this paper is to present a general overview and categorization of the Castro rock cut features. The research, with a permit by the Greek Archaeological Service and the Ministry of Culture, includes field work with surface surveying and recording, photogrammetry and topography, as well as the study of mobile finds resulting from subsurface investigation related to selected rock cut features. Surface and subsurface data point till now towards dating the features at least from the Bronze Age up to the Hellenistic period without excluding a larger time span. Diachronic uses may be attested in certain areas, although they are not necessarily constant nor generalized. Radiochronology, anthropological and metallurgical analysis, as well as the study of mobile finds and organic residues are currently in progress. The roughness, irregularity and colors variability of the rocks covered with lichens, as well as erosion and man-made destruction, complicate the task for the identification of the structures, which are often invisible, even when above the surface. Besides what seem to be significant monoliths, there are various types of rock cut structures in isolation or in combinations, suggesting utilitarian objectives, but also unknown functions. These include circular cavities, well systems and conduits, the latter sometimes along flights of steps or connected to angles of rooms or platforms or to other carved structures related to water liquids management. Carved rooms or platforms, which consist mostly of two or three vertical walls that form angle and contain part of a rock floor, steps, niches and benches. Stepped ramps join them to higher or lower similar structures on your right. Intercommunicating ensembles of smaller rooms are also attested. They are often combined, besides to niches, also to other features carved in the space which is delimited by them, such as benches, steps, vertical or horizontal post holes, and large cavities. Numerous ramps, stepped ramps and carved steps of various dimensions and numbers. Longer passageways, often suggesting intercommunication itineraries, linking carved complexes and sectors. Partly natural and partly artificial boulders or outcrops with carved small steps and niches. And a number of petroglyphs on vertical surface of boulders or niches on walls or floors of rooms, platforms, or closed cavities. The extent and complexity of the features implies a multifunctional site. Indeed, combinations of rock cut features may indicate symbolic behaviors related at the same time to concrete uses of space. For example, in an area with a view over the sea, a carved main road oriented west-east is crossed by two descending flights of carved steps or stepped ramps, the latter directed towards the coast. At crossroads, a number of female implements and fragments of figurines, some of them wearing Apollo's headgear and or enthroned, were found, possibly close to an open-air altar. Although traces of delimited spaces might constitute possible dwellings, which would be consistent with water collection structures, passageways and platforms, as well as with the harbor area, still several rock cut features are not adapted for habitation, being too small or not understandable. Spaces of unclear interpretation include small structures of invisible, complicated, or very difficult access. Among those, there are restricted groups of small steps of obscure use, as they stop in the rock and do not seem to lead anywhere. For example, two flights of steps with an approximately east-west orientation, partly diverging from each other, become narrower on their higher parts and stop into the rock without any visible issue. They are dead ends, terminating with the last small step at a carved vertical panel with a cavity. In the upper end of both flights of steps, some device or object could be embedded or inserted into dowel holes, if the latter were not cup marks or libation holes. The ensemble reminds us of the so-called open-air rock carved sanctuaries in Thrace, dated from at least the late Bronze Age onwards, as well as the stepped altars with an upper idol-shaped seat, well known from Phrygia, where they have been associated in particular to Iron Age cults, although with a long prehistory in previous centuries. Bronze Age and Iron Age seem to be confirmed by mobile finds, probably attesting ritual proceedings in front of one of such flights of steps. Besides, it would not seem a coincidence that both previously mentioned dead ends bifurcate from a carved south-north passageway, which itself ends with a flight of descending steps. In fact, starting from the base of the first described stepped ramp, one can reach another flight of steps towards the north-northeast, this time much wider, lower, and easier to climb on than the others. This staircase leads to a large carved cube-shaped outcrop and to some other carved features. The implication is that this is again a crossroads. In fact, three ways with diverging directions are crossing at this space: the flights of ascending steps to the west, a carved south-north passageway, and the wide staircase leading to the cubic outcrop towards the north-northeast. In antiquity, such crossroads were considered as important, liminal, even dangerous places where various divinities received ritual offerings. In other cases, a number of flights of steps seem to start and to stop in the middle of the natural rock with no obvious reason. In particular, a large rock is carved on various places with narrow stepped ramps comprising a few steps, ascending or descending tracks and passages, not easily recognizable as such. This situation shows more complicated patterns than utilitarian trajectories or simple routine, as in other castral areas. This induced behavior in space in a complicated itinerary might suggest symbolic proceedings. Besides everyday practice, trails, paths, and roads may indeed serve important functions of enactment during processions and rituals. Such paths carved into the rock could suggest open-air cult, as attested at least since the Bronze and Iron Age and the Archaic period in Greece, with abundant evidence of parallels, as already mentioned, also from the east and the north, on high places, hills or mountains, involving processions and other ritual performances. A main feature of the Castro coastal rock-cut site is definitely its proximity with water, in particular the omnipresence of the Aegean Sea, obviously surrounding the peninsula. This becomes obvious with the communication of the main carved ramp of the first described crossroad, more or less parallel to the coast, at the edge of the cliffs, with lower levels, as more ramps and steps are directed toward the sea, at the same time permitting intercommunication between carved rectangular spaces or platforms. These itineraries involve planning out of preset directed movement, providing access from higher levels towards areas close to the present coast and vice versa. Moreover, some areas with rock-cut features could have served diachronically as observation posts towards the entrance of the harbour and the open sea beyond, but also attest industrial activities and possibly ritual. The importance of the sea and the involvement of people with maritime matters is emphasized by a monumental sheet petroglyph on a rock-cut structure in the harbor, also confirming its symbolic significance. Indeed, according to the current stage of research, both on fixed features and mobile artifacts, besides other aspects, the intricate maritime associations at the Castro rock-cut headland would have involved not only concrete components, such as seashells, lots of them, and obviously imported by sea artifacts and raw material, among others, a lead ingot, but also symbolic facets, such as graffiti with ship representations on shirts. Furthermore, figurines and other female artifacts of historic periods congregating in this transitional place at the border between the sea and the rocky landscape attest an intriguing female presence. In this connection, it seems significant that in 7th century BC, Hephaestia, by the northern coast of Lemnos, the local goddess, also named Lemnos, was a divinity of nature, in particular protecting water, since wells and several fountain models seem to have been dedicated to her. This local divinity would be related to other goddesses of nature, such as the Thracian Bendis and the Anatolian Matar or Cybele, but also Hecate and Artemis. Hecate was an early goddess of entryways and crossroads, also connected with doorways and boundaries. Artemis, whose cult became important in Lemnos since the classical period, is a goddess associated with boundaries and liminality, including headlands, coastal areas, and offshore anchorages. In conclusion of this overview, during successive phases of prehistory and antiquity on Castro, diachronic human action has influenced the maritime and rocky landscape, while at the same time, topography guided choices of natural forms and spaces and prompted courses of action related both to concrete and transcendental objectives. Megalithic formations reveal a composite scenery entailing an elaborate artificial system of space occupation within nature, while carved ensembles appear indeed to have had both symbolic and utilitarian components, materializing specific concerns and purposes, and therefore also revealing human forethought and deliberation. Thank you very much.